Welcome to the Iowa Weekly Seminar. It's my great pleasure to have Dr. Carol Morales, I butchered that, I'm sure, with us today. Before we start, I just want to acknowledge that the IOF seminar comes from the Point Grey campus of UBC, which is on the traditional and unceded territory of the Musqueam people. This is a hybrid seminar, so for those of you online who wish to ask questions, either type them into the chat or raise your virtual hand on Zoom and we'll get to them. For those in the room, I think you probably know how you can ask questions. This is a discussion of scientific ideas, and so we want to ensure that this is a productive and polite conversation, and we ask people to think about how they're framing their comments or questions in that light. So with that out of the way, let me tell you a little bit about Carol. Carol joined the Marine Mammal Research Unit about a year ago, officially. Carol is an expert in conservation of manatees and dolphins in South America. She originally got her PhD in marine tropical sciences from the Marine Sciences Institute at the Federal University of Brazil. She's been working at marine conservation for over 25 years. She has, and this is both sort of academic and practical aspects of conservation. She actually established a marine mammal rehab center for manatees in South America. Maybe she'll show us some video of that. It's quite exciting. She is currently coordinating the Alliance for Manatees project here at UBC, which is focused on identifying critical habitat for this species for the conservation across South America. She's a member of the IUCN Sirenian Specialist Group, collaborating extensively with people internationally and but particularly in South America. And that is all focused on the practical conservation of this group of animals. So without taking up any more time, I'm going to hand it over to Carol and her amazing manatees.
Thank you, Dave. Thank you, everyone, for being here. I'm really glad to talk a little bit about what I have been doing for the last 25 years for manatee conservation in South America, specifically in Brazil. And I have to admit that it was a challenge to put this presentation together. How do you put 25 years of work in a 40-minute presentation? So I hope I found the right way to show you a little bit about this and that you enjoy the narrative. So before I talk about manatees, because most of you don't know me, I want to talk about a little bit about myself and how I ended up studying manatees in South America. So this is where I grew up. This is Brasilia, the capital of Brazil. And for those that don't know where is Brasilia, it's here in the middle of Brazil. So no ocean at all. Brasilia is surrounded by this beautiful forest called Cerrado, is unique forest from Brazil. But every year I spend summers on Itaparica Island in Bahia that looks like Caribbean. And this amazing place where my father used to spend his summers and where my great-great-grandmother was an indigenous woman from Tupinambá tribe. And then we moved as a family to Fortaleza, in northeastern Brazil, plenty of ocean to study. And this is where I started to study biology of marine mammals after I dropped out the engineering school, but I won't talk about this here. If you want to know more, we can talk about this later. And as a biology student in my first year, I was invited as a volunteer to take care of this dolphin that's stranded alive in a beach close to Fortaleza. There was a study group in the university called Cetacean Study Group, and it was part of the university and an NGO called Aquasis. So I was fascinated about that animal. It was my first encounter with a marine mammal because I was from Brasilia. And I asked for an internship, and then I start as a first student, first year student to study marine mammals. And most of the work at that time was related to strainings. And we had all kind of strainings, dolphins, whales, manatees. We found like just decomposed carcass. We found live animals, and we had to attend all these trainings. And there was no much funding for this. Sometimes we had to drive with our own family car and sleep in like at the church. And we did our best to do this. And I was really intrigued about and fascinated about how a straining or study straining animals could provide us valuable data to gather information about marine mammals, like which species occur in that area, why are they dying, are there natural causes or human-related causes, and is collect samples to study the species biology and identify age, reproduction, and what are they eating, and all this kind of information. Also samples to evaluate levels of contaminants and pathogens. So this was my first line of work, strainings of marine mammals in general. I studied Guyana dolphins, that is the species that most of the strainings are related to the species because of bycatch. So I studied animals incidentally capturing gillnets, study species that were never reported before in this area, like false killer whales and mink whales. And this involved also to study the morphology of the schools, so we could identify the species based only in these parts of the body that were found at the beach. And then in 2001, there was my first manatee training. It was a baby manatee, a newborn manatee called Açu. We call this in Tupi Guarani, that is an indigenous language in Brazil, it means big, because it was a big newborn. But we were at the university, we had no rehabilitation facilities, we have this children's pool that we put in a lab and took care of this animal for 3-4 days, but we had to fly with this animal from Fortaleza to Recife, where that time there was the only rehabilitation center for West Indian manatees in Brazil. And I was really curious about manatees trainings, because at that point I had only attended cetaceans trainings, and I got to the data of this group, and I said that there was a high incidence of West Indian manatee trainings in this area, especially newborns. And because probably you don't know much about manatees, before I go deep in this subject, I want to talk a little bit about these animals. They are part of the Sirenia order. There are 5 species of Sirenias, and 3 manatees, Amazonian, West Indian, and African, the dugong and the stellar sea cow. And a fun fact about the name Sirenia, if you don't know, in Greek, it means mermaid. And I don't know why. The story says that Columbus sailors, when they first arrived in America, they saw manatees and they thought they were ugly mermaids. So here is a map showing Sirenia species distribution. And inside the square, you can see South America, where I have been working. But if you notice here, where we are, North Pacific Ocean, there is Sirenia species, the stellar sea cow. Actually, there was. In 1768, just 25 years, this species was first described, it was considered extinct because of poaching. So if you want to know a little bit more about the stellar sea cow biogeography, you can read this recent published paper published by a PhD student at IRS, Iris, here on the floor, that happens to be my husband. And yeah, you had probably a few hundred years ago a sea cow swimming with harbor seals and otters in BC waters. So going back to South America, we have two manatee species. You're so lucky, have two manatee species there. Amazonian manatee that occurs in the Amazon basin, and the West Indian manatee that occurs mainly in marine and estuarine areas, but also in, for example, in Colombia and Venezuela in freshwater habitats. And both species are classified as vulnerable by the IUCN. So back to the manatee strandings in the state of Ceará, I started to study what was going on with the species in the state. And not only the calves, but also the adults, there were not a lot of strandings that I went to the San Marcos Valley. And this was the subject of my undergraduate thesis that I ended up publishing a few years later after I graduate. And we discovered that in 15 years of a study of strainings, most 83% were related to newborn calves. And the main hypothesis for this is habitat loss, because mangrove deforestation to build salt and shrimp farms in this area estuaries. So the estuaries are siltated and the females can't go inside to give birth. So they are giving birth in the open waters and the calf can follow the mother due to waves and currents and ended up straining. And the second cause is bycatch. Adults in bottom trawling and the calves in gill nets. So with this in hand, we build an action plan to increase collaboration, to do environmental awareness, research, rescue, rehabilitation, and release, and advocate for public policy to conservate the species, not only in the state of Ceará, but also the neighborhood states, Rio Grande do Norte and Piauí. So for research, we start doing interview with fishermen to gather traditional ecological knowledge. Where are the manatees? What do they eat? Where they drink fresh water? That's important. I don't know if you know that manatee needs to drink fresh water. And that's why their habitat are closely related to river mouths, estuaries, and also freshwater springs. And then we start to gather information about potential foraging areas, the seagrass meadows in this area, the freshwater springs, distribution where the animals are, core areas, and also behavior through land-based platform monitoring. And this resulted in several publications in collaboration with a lot of researchers from Brazil and outside Brazil as well. And we also published a book in 2016 with several researchers from Brazil. It's in Portuguese and in English. It's available in PDF. And if you are interested in reading about manatees in Brazil, you can go to my research gate, it's there. So related to public policies, once we knew where manatees were and the core areas, we started to advocate for the creation of marine protected areas, especially in this place, it's called Icapuí. It's the eastern coast of the state of Ceará. So there are now three protected areas there. The one in the middle was just a proposal, but it was created last year. And we also did research that helped to establish restricted areas within protected areas, like areas where should be restricted to motorboats or gill nets to protect these animals. We also as part of national public policies, like action plans, governmental action plans, and participated in workshops to assess the extinction risk of manatees in Brazil. For environmental awareness, we produce a lot of material. We produce two children's books. This one is really interesting. It's about a baby manatee that meets this boy, this kid, and tells him about all the threats and what he can do to change what is going on and protect the species. He also did some events like parades and with manatee costumes and regatas, especially in those communities that were related to bycatch, like communities that the main fisheries were bottom trawling. So we did a lot of work there so they could understand that manatees are an important part of the environment. Related to rescue, rehabilitation, and release, we already did rescue, as I told you, but we improved this rescue to, how can I say, we did a lot of capacity building with people from the community so they could be the first responders and we could increase the survival of the stranded animals. And we also started a beach monitoring project. And actually we rescued two live newborns during this beach monitoring projects. But as I told you before, as you can see in the right picture, we had no rehabilitation facility at all. We had to fly to send these animals to Recife. And these animals were rehabilitated and released in other areas close to this rehabilitation facility. So from scratch, we started to fundraise and we were able to build a marine mammal rehabilitation center, especially for manatees. And these are the two first patients that were rehabilitated there, Alva and Maceió. They stranded in 2012 and they were already released back to nature. So, and an important step of manatees rehabilitation is acclimatization. You can't just put an animal that spend like 3-4 years in a tank, concrete tank, and put it back to the water. It has to understand how the tides work, the currents, and also there are a lot of different noises and animals. So acclimatization is an important part of the process. And because this population of manatees lives exclusively in marine waters, they don't enter estuaries in this region anymore, we had to do something in the open ocean. So this is the first floating pen for manatee acclimatization that was built in Brazil. The others are in estuaries. And of course, after acclimatization comes release and monitoring. You can just release and let it go. You need to understand where is the animal? Is the animal okay? Where is it going? Because as an example, there was a manatee that traveled 5,000 kilometers to Venezuela. Yeah, and it's there now. So it's another story, we can talk about this later. But we need to track this animal. So as you can see in the right side of this picture, there's something floating, it's not garbage, it's the tracking device that is attached to the manatee tail. It looks weird. It looks like a big thing to be carrying, but it was developed like 30 years ago by people from Florida that have been working with manatees for a long time. And the picture here on the top right, it's a device that was developed in Brazil recently, and it's still we're still seeing how it works, but it's smaller and it's cheaper to get the data, because you have to download the data. It comes from the site. For satellites, you have to download, so the national technology is cheaper. And that comes a new long flight, not a managed flight, but me and my family, we moved from Fortaleza to Vancouver. But I couldn't stop thinking about manatees. I know I wanted to keep working with marine mammals, but I wanted to keep working with manatees. So thank you, Andrew. But before I came to the Marine Mammal Research Unit, I thought, okay, how can I keep working with manatees from here? And I was really, I started to think about extinction risk because I participated in some workshops in Brazil to evaluate manatees extinction risk. And I was curious about the process because it is usually like you go to these workshops for 3 days and evaluate like 25 species. How can you do a good evaluation of 25 species in 3 days? And because in 2008, the Brazilian government classified manatees as critically endangered and downlisted the species in 2014 without provide any information about this was genuine change in conservation status or there is better information available to do the assessment. We didn't know that, so I invited some friends to do the assessment. Brazilian use IUCN guidelines, so I invited some friends to do this assessment, an independent assessment that could help the Brazilian government in the next meeting to do evaluation. So for the first time, we estimated the extent of occurrence. I don't know if you are familiar with IUCN guidelines, but you basically estimate the area where the species is. And we updated the distribution map for manatees, identify areas when the species no longer occur because it was extirpated, or areas where the species does not occur because there is no suitable habitat. And we also projected the population size in different scenarios of mortality based on the stranding numbers. And we identified that the species was critically endangered in this country. And last month, there was a meeting in Brazil to update the assessment. Even because of this paper, the Brazilian government decided the next list, the species will be uplisted. It doesn't mean that now it's more endangered than before, but now there is more data to help with this evaluation. And then also, I was invited to be an editor of the LAJAN is the Latin American Journal of Aquatic Mammals. There was a special issue on manatees. I was invited to be the leader editor. And I also published in this issue paper about hypothesis for the newborn strandings. Because even, okay, we were rescuing animals, we were creating protected areas, but the animals are still stranding. And we don't know for sure what's going on there. So we raised hypotheses for these strandings and that need to be investigated to understand better what's going on. But with all this, one thing really important came is I noticed how that working in collaboration is important and how much information we can get from collaboration, works in collaboration. And this is how the Alliance for Manatees was born here at the Marine Mammal Research Unit. With the first The first goals of this alliance was to identify critical habitats for manatee conservation in South America through collaborative research. Basically, several manatee experts or knowledge holders from South America, they have data on manatee presence. They are not available in other, not in public databases, nor in papers. So they sent me their data so I could perform habitat modeling analysis, and we could identify suitable habitats for manatees in South America. And based on these maps, we can create a map of critical areas for conservation. At the end, we are going to share these maps with stakeholders from these countries, South America countries, so they can guide conservation, like where do we need to create protected areas, or if there is already a protected area, what can we do to increase protection? And I'm just gonna show you a little bit what we already did in the Alliance for Manatees. We did modeling for this, separate the area in 8 areas based on manatee habitat. And we modeled the habitat for each one of them using data that they sent to us. And as an example, this is area 2 where I used to work. The red dots, or sorry, the green dots are the presence data, manatee presence data. In this case, you use only accurate data like sightings and telemetry. In other areas, we only had like strandings and you used what you had. And this is the modeling results, the probability of manatee presence in this region and the suitable habitat. So last month we had a workshop in Brazil to present these results to the experts so they could validate it or not. And they worked really hard. And this workshop was in Capuí. I'm gonna show you a video at the end, and you're gonna see this beautiful place. So as an example, this is what they worked on this, and they presented to us what their thought about the map. And for the area 2, they think it's not the reality. They think it should be larger than the modeling showed. So I wanted to understand why the modeling is not, we know that modeling is not the reality. It's what works best with your data. But what's the problem? And they said, oh, we have more data to send you. And this data is in this area that it's not included in the results. So, okay, I have to rerun the model for most of the areas. And we also discussed during the workshop next steps for the Alliance. There were a lot of suggestions, but the most important was capacity building. There are countries like Suriname that some people never heard about it, but it's they speak Dutch there. But there's one person working with manatees there that is not a biologist, and she's doing her best, but she need help so we can go there and let them know, teach them the techniques, how to do a field survey, how to use site scan sonar to study manatees. So this is an example. Also roadmap for action plan, like what are the most important projects that need to be done for manatee? Not only conservation, but if you need to know how many animals are there so we can implement like monitoring to understand trends. This is important to be in this roadmap. Guidelines to estimate abundance, because in this area, because of dark waters, it's really a challenge to estimate manatee abundance, and there is also hunting. So manatees in this area develop a shy behavior. It's really hard to see them. And also advocate for rehabilitation facilities, because most of these countries in South America don't have rehabilitation facilities for manatees. So before we finish, I want to show you, I think it's a 4 minutes video about Estevão translocation. Estevão stranded in 2018. He was a newborn manatee calf stranded in Estevão Beach. And Aracati was rescued by our collaborator Tercio Villardi, that has an education program in this city. And so Estevão is 6 years old. He was rehabilitated in the Aquazes Marine Mammal Rehabilitation Center. And he was translocated to the floating pen in Capuí that I show you. So this, you will be able to see this, the how Capuí looks like, and a little bit about the pen. It's in Portuguese, but there is no much talks there. I can like guide you through the video so you can understand what's being done. So let me see.
Hoje nós estamos aqui para realizar a translocação do Estevão, né? Um animal de 6 anos de idade. Está aqui no centro de reabilitação, que fica no SESC de Parana, em Caucaia. E logo mais a gente vai começar o manejo para preparar esse animal para ele seguir para o cativeiro de aclimatação em Capuí, para sua última fase de reabilitação e aclimatação para poder ser som.
There's a light sedation. Put water on him every like 10 minutes. So the truck is leaving the rehabilitation center in Fortaleza, going to Capuí now.
Thank you.
Okay, and then I'd like to thank all the institutions that are part of the Alliance for Manatees. And some of them were represented there during the workshop discussing with us, but we have now 23 manatee experts in the Alliance, but we want to invite more people from South America to join us. And also I'd like to thank the financial support of the Nuremberg Zoo, Paradise Foundation, Yaku Pacha, and IUCN, because without their support, we couldn't be doing this workshop and all this analysis for manatee conservation. And that's it. Thank you so much. Thank you for listening.
Okay. Thank you very much, Carol. I'm just going to ask you, when we have questions from the room or online, if you could just briefly summarize them for the other group of folks. And yeah. So, but I'll let you, do you want to handle the question or you want me to pick them?
Yeah.
Okay.
Jennifer.
I have a question about the engineering background. It's also like super impressive the amount of work that you have done. From the research aspect to the conservation was amazing. So I have three small questions that are interconnected. The first one is how, like, what are the survival rates for the manatees when they are, when they are rescued in the sample, especially thinking about the young, the newborn, and then how long does it take for them to be rehabilitated, and what's the survival rates after they are released back to the environment? Thank you,
Jennifer. Jennifer has three questions. The first one is about the survival rate of the rescued manatees. It's pretty high because most of them is trained in very good shape. They are newborns, umbilical cord yet, but they are like okay, like no sickness or dehydration because we have this people supporting us. So it's really quick, the rescue. And I would say, I don't have the numbers here, but I would say that 95% is pretty high. The second question is, how long does it take for the whole rehabilitation process? So it's really long because usually the calves stay with their mother for 2 years. So we need to like feed them with special formula for 2 years at least. And because in this rehabilitation center, we started to release the animals when they were 6 years old. It's late, it's not the ideal. There are animals there with 8 years old that are 8 years old now. But ideally 5 years old is a good age to start to release these animals. And we still don't have numbers about the survival rate of the released animals because it's really, they started to release the animals in 2021. And because it's something new in Brazil, the other rehabilitation facilities, acclimatization facilities are in estuaries. It's really easier for the animals to adapt and to follow them. But this is a marine area, open area. So one of the animals traveled to Venezuela and other animals just lost the tracking device. So there we don't have numbers, but for the other area in Brazil, it's 75% of success. Thank you.
Jordan.
Yeah, that's great. So I'm still a bit unclear about what causes the high stranding rates. I'm wondering if there like spatial variation in high stranding rates, are there areas where they don't really strand that much? And then you make inferences about the sort of nursery hot effects in the rat one.
Yeah, that's a really good question. It's about the newborn strainings in this area. Why are they happening? And if we have data from another areas, if it's the same pattern or where are the nursery areas? This area, one of the hypotheses is the habitat loss is the main cause. Other areas in Brazil, the straining rates are much, much lower. There are strainings, but not like in this area. And the difference is that in this area, manatees are not found in the estuaries anymore. They used to be like 30 years ago, but now the estuaries are like shallow, hypersaline. There is no fresh water for them anymore inside. So we believe that this habitat loss, the animals are changing the way they are using the area. So they are, it's like, they try an error, they have to try again, where the females have to figure out where they need to go to give birth. So maybe they go to the wrong side, wrong area, like with strong currents and waves, and the calves ended up straining. It's one of the hypotheses.
Sarah.
So it seems that seahorses and manatees have more in common than just being slow and gorgeous.
I agree.
So, can you tell us a little more about how that threat is being mitigated, if at all? Because obviously, releases are great, but if we release them to be swept up in bottom trawl, it's a challenge.
So, yeah. Sarah is asking about the bottom trawling and if how are we mitigating this threat. The thing in this area, bottom trawling is already occurring in the area where it's not supposed to be. So there's enforcement. They need to do enforcement. But there is no shrimp outside this area. So the local communities need to fish to survive. So we need to balance how to deal with this because you also need them, people that live there, to help us to protect the species. So it's not an easy task. And we are working with the communities so them to avoid the hotspots where manatees occur, to reduce the chance of, because it's not good for them to capture manatees. It destroys the net. It's terrible for them too. So they don't want this. So we are working with them.
We have a couple of questions online. Natasha, can I get you to read it out for me? For us?
Yeah. Andrew's asking, could you talk a bit about the type of habitat mapping you do and the types of species?
Okay. Do I need to repeat?
Yeah.
Okay. It. Andrew's asking about the habitat modeling techniques and which species can be applied. I'm using presence only data modeling analysis because we don't have the effort. We have like just the presence points, and it can be applied to any species if you have, because you need to have not only the presence data, but you need to have information, the layers of the variables that can be important for the species, like where is the seagrass, where are the seagrass meadows, where are the freshwater springs, like variables that could explain the species presence. So if you have both data, presence data, and the variables, you can apply for a lot of species.
Yeah, the last question from Juan Jose is asking, do you have any insights in the recent mass mortality of Amazon pink river dolphins? Or in Brazil, was higher water temperature and heat the culprit in the face of climate change?
Yeah, Juan Jose asked about the mass mortality of Amazon river dolphins that last year, like almost 300 dolphins died during the drought in the Amazon. And yeah, it was because of the water temperature reached almost 40 degrees Celsius. So the animals died of shock because of this high temperature. And this year they were expecting the same thing, but it was not so bad. But it's a combination of, I think, climate change, of course, with the change, like because the drought is so severe now that there was last year there was no water at all, so the water temperature in these small places where there was still water was like too high for them, and there were no manatees there. I don't know why, if manatees like were able to detect this and move quicker than the dolphins, but yeah, it's important. I think we're gonna see this for the next years several times, unfortunately.
I'm curious to know what was the relationship between the local humanity before your interventions, and for instance here have First Nations communities that have a strong connection with Kiwi rights, for instance. So I wonder if you had to start from scratch that sensitization and that connection, or if it already existed.
It was from scratch because. Oh, sorry. Yeah. And
they might think you're baking. <that episode. laughs>
The question was how we start the awareness, if there was some connection from. Of people that live there with manatees already, or we had to start from scratch. And they saw manatees as a source of food because hunting was a reality there like 30 years ago. And in some of these communities, manatees that were caught in fisheries, they ate them. We saw, we rescued rescued carcasses that were like had meat removed for them to eat. So it was from scratch.